should have quit, but he didn't. He could have quit. Anybody else would have quit. I have to be honest, I would have quit. Yes, Lord, he should have opened his mouth, but the Bible said he opened not his mouth. He should have called 10,000 angels. He should have come down from the cross. No one would have blamed him. What we deserve is obvious, but he couldn't do that. He was committed to me. He was committed to you. Yes, Lord.
That Jesus, enduring his passion, had a week worse than what you and I can imagine. I want you to know that we should not hold out anything on Jesus. He's done too much for us to have church. He's done too much for us to make church optional. My sisters and brothers, I don't know about you, but I love the Lord. Not only because he heard my cry and answered my call, but I love the Lord because he's done more for me than even my mother and my father could even imagine. They may have brought me into this world and took care of me, but if it had not been for the Lord who was on my side, I don't know where I'd be. My mother and my father, my grandmother and my grandfather had to subscribe to the same God that I'm talking about. Because if he would have said, lay down and die, there was nothing they could do. That's why when we come to church on Sunday morning, on Wednesday night, and on our Sunday morning Sunday school, we ought to come with a passion in our hearts. My sisters and brothers, we are grateful again for this opportunity to serve the Lord. This is the week leading up to Good Friday. This is the one of the Advent weeks, and this is one of the weeks leading up to his passion. Now, my sisters and brothers, I don't know how much you know about the passion of Christ, but I hope to share with you what it is in the message. My heart gets heavy always around this time because of what my God and Savior suffered for me. And it should keep you driven all the year until the next year to serve him with a passion. This morning, we would like to invite your attention and ask that you come with me to the book of Isaiah, chapter 53. Isaiah, chapter 53. We want to begin at verse 3. Isaiah 53. Verse 3, we will continue to verse 7. Isaiah 53:3, reading from the New King James Version, we find these words so written. He is despised and rejected by men, a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief. we hid, as it were, our faces from him. He was despised, and we did not esteem him. Surely he has borne our griefs and carried our sorrows. Yet we esteemed him stricken, smitten by God, and afflicted. But he was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him, and by his stripes we are healed. All we like sheep have gone astray. We have turned everyone to his own way. And the Lord has said on him, laid on him the iniquities of us all. He was oppressed. He was afflicted. Yet he opened not his mouth. He was led as a lamb to the slaughter, and as a sheep before its shears is silent, so he opened not his mouth. You may be seated. Isaiah 53 and 3 through 7. And my sisters and brothers, I don't know what you come from, but I come to worship God.
Yes, sir. Amen.
Isaiah chapter 53 is the summit, the Mount Everest of biblical prophecy.
Right, sir.
In this chapter, the Savior of the world is seen suffering for the sins of the human race. And the scene and meaning of his death are described in surprising detail. For true believers, Isaiah 53 is one of the most heartbreaking yet cherished passages of Scripture. It describes the brutal treatment and horrible suffering Christ endured on our behalf. A marked feature of this 53rd chapter is the vicarious substitutionary death of God's suffering servant, the promised Messiah. Emphasizing this theme time and again in this chapter, Isaiah produces that the Savior will die for our sins. He will die in our place, on our behalf, in our stead, for us as our substitute, paying the penalty of sin for us. The Savior will set us free from the bondage of sin, death, and hell. Through his death, we have received from God the most amazing healing and salvation. We have been saved from the bondage of sin and death, and from the coming terrifying judgment of God against all unrepented sinners. Meditating on the suffering of Christ will break a person's heart, for they overwhelm human imagination. I know I haven't been given a title yet, but I'm working. Christ bore all the sadistic, brutal treatment due you and me. Yes, every one of us grasping this truth is bound to be driven to the ground on our faces before our Savior. But you got to grasp. You got to understand what Jesus has done for you. Well, my sisters and brothers, interestingly, this prophecy about the Messiah's suffering was written more than 700 years before Christ was ever born. And it causes us to wonder sometime, was it about Jesus Christ? But I want to assure you, it was about Jesus. Well, a new speaker began. A new speaker now comes to the forefront. When we look at this 53rd chapter, while the speaker is not identified, the picture is that of believers discussing the Savior's death and the world rejecting him. While Christ walked on earth, he suffered rejection because he seemed to be of no consequences and was totally misunderstood. Down through the centuries, the vast majority of people have continued to reject God's servant, the Savior of the world, the Lord Jesus Christ. The Savior coming, the Savior's coming has been predicted, but prophecy had been rejected. That's what we saw in verse 1. Well, time and time again, God had foretold that he would send the Messiah into the world. But very few believed the prophecy. That's like today, there are so many that don't believe what is being preached and taught in the world. But you know, one thing we need to know, they denied that God could or would use his power, or you might see in the scripture, you know, to do such a thing as even send a Savior to the world. Or else they denied the need for a Savior, believing that the people were capable and wise enough to meet their own needs. Well, I want to tell you, you're not wise enough. You're not smart enough. You don't have the ability to meet your own needs. Well, my sisters and brothers, with all of that, I want to share with you from the title this morning, He Suffered for Me. He Suffered for Me. Well, in 2016, I sat and watched the Passion of Christ. Well, the word passion comes from the Latin word for suffering. It usually refers to the last 12 hours of Christ's earthly life. From his agony in the Garden of Gethsemane to his death on the cross. I told you I would tell you what passion means, but I believe you missed it. Well, it was the last 12 hours of Christ in the earth before his death. In other words, it entails his agony in the Garden of Gethsemane until he died. Lord have mercy. His agony in the garden until his death on the cross. Well, the movie is about what Jesus did for me and not about what they did to Jesus. I wish I had changed. Well, my sisters and brothers, this might not be what you're looking for, but I've got to tell you what God intended for me to tell you. Well, it is a film that depicts the graphic nature of the last 12 hours of the life of Christ. As I sat there, my heart ached while I watched the treatment of my Jesus. You need to watch it one day. But in my day, I've been mistreated.
Yes.
I've been scorned. But it pales when I consider what Jesus endured just for me. In my day, I've been talked about as sure as you are born. But as we used to say, sticks and stones may break my bones, but words will never hurt. You know, we used to say that, but I don't know about that. The thing they said about me did not hurt like the things they did to Jesus. Well, in my day, I have made enemies like bees make honey. But my enemies never did me in. Thanks be to God, never before have I sat and experienced the movie on such a personal and convicting level. I wept as I witnessed the soldiers scourge the sinner's sinless Lamb of God. My tears fell one by one, but I will say they fell by the pound. Well, my sisters and brothers, I saw them beat him while at the same time grinning like Jack in the Box gestures. Well, all of a sudden, I had a rising and urgent need for an emotional release. My streams of tears, I saw them beat him with unnerving frequency. Even though his body looked like it would unpeel with the next series of licks or blows. Through all of this, the Son of Man stood up to all their abuse. I'm trying to paint a picture. They gave it all they had. He took the best shots they had. Jesus paid it all, and I know that all to him I owe. I don't know about you, but I sat there chained to my seat, winching with every blow. I left with a greater appreciation of what he suffered for me. Well, I studied with extreme distaste the brutal beating that was inflicted upon my Lord and my God. No mortal could withstand the punishment that was laid upon Jesus. It had to be the God man. You would have had to be shot up with Novocaine not to have your life eternally impacted and changed forever by what Jesus suffered on our behalf. Well, I left the room forever changed. Yes, Lord, the Gospel of Mark simply says about Jesus' death, and they crucified him in chapter 15 and 24. Then they nailed him to the cross. They nailed him to the cross. Such a short and simple statement sounds almost acceptably polite. Well, my sisters and brothers, maybe something that occurred over 2,000 years ago feels sanitized to us. But I come back to tell you, it should not feel sanitized. Well, my sisters and brothers, you need to know we forget the condition of his body when this occurred. He was beaten, bloody, Lord have mercy, exhausted, decimated, beyond recognition as a man. I'm trying to get you to see what Jesus Christ suffered for us. Well, my sisters and brothers, we forget the humility of the cross. God's Son hanging there like a piece of meat, Lord have mercy, in a butcher's cutting room. Well, my sisters and brothers, we forget the sound of the 3 9-inch nail that pierced his hand and his feet, plunging deep into the hard wood of the cross. Yes, we forget that it was not the gods, the politicians, or the temple hierarchy that nailed him there. It was God Almighty. Well, because of your sins and my sins, God nailed his own Son to the cruel cross. All so that you and I could be forgiven. It was your sins that nailed him there. It was my sins that nailed him there. Look at your neighbor and say, neighbor, he suffered it all for me. Well, Jesus died so that we could be redeemed by his shed blood on Calvary. Christ died, my sisters and brothers, so your sins could be nailed to the cross. To fully understand and appreciate his sacrifice, I researched the subject of crucifixion. Bear with me here. The following is what I found in searching and researching the crucifixion. The sources escaped me, but the facts are still fresh in my mind. I'm indebted to the doctor whose findings I quote. Well, first of all, death by crucifixion is essentially death by affixation. When you hang on the cross and the weight of your body pulls down on the intercostal, pectoral, and deltoid muscles around your lung, you reach a state where when the weight is dragging down on them, you can inhale, but you are increasingly unable to exhale. Well, until you reach a place of almost paralysis and you can't exhale at all. Well, actually, in the 1950s, an experiment was done.
Come on now.
In West Germany, where these male volunteered and were asked to be tied to the 2x4 that served as the cross. Well, these males lost conscience at a maximum of 12 minutes. I'm just talking about my research. Now, on the cross, you can push up if only on the nails or whatever you can push up on. Well, and when you push up, you relieve those muscles in your lungs, but when you pull back down on them again, because you can't stay up long, you pull down, and when you are in a low position on the cross, you asphyxiate. Well, you may have heard ministers talk about that every now and then Jesus would raise himself up on the nails in his feet. That was so he could exhale. Well, my sisters and brothers, I want you to know the Roman historian did not have to have a degree in medicine. If the person is hanging low on the cross for any amount of time, let's say 30 minutes, then you can mark him off, he's dead. Well, second, we were told that they stabbed Jesus in the chest and blood and water came out. When I said in the chest, they went under his his arm, but in the chest. Well, my sisters and brothers, listen, someone said, well, that's in the Gospel of John, and we are not going to give you that realm. Well, that's all right. Let me tell you this. In the ancient crucifixion accounts, there are a number of accounts of coup de grace. And what coup de grace means is a crushing blow. That's done at the end of the crucifixion to end the account. In other words, when you are almost dead, it's great for them to go ahead and kill you. You know how folk at the vet said, when an animal is injured, the best thing is not to allow him to suffer, but go on and put him to sleep. That's called the coup. When in relationship to the crucifixion. Well, we have an account of a man whose skull was crushed to finish the process. A man who was threatened with a bow and arrow. We have two other cases outside of Jesus in the Gospel of John where he was stabbed to make sure he was dead. Well, and of course, we have what's known as the crucifrigion. In other words, in Latin, it is the breaking of the ankle so the person cannot push themselves up in it longer. In all these cases, here's what the executioner is saying. You are not getting off this cross alive. Well, that's what they told Jesus. That's why they did what they did. You are not coming down alive. Well, so reason number one, if you are low on the cross, you're dead. You asphyxiated. Number two, the death blow or the coup de grace. The death blow in the case of Jesus, were told that it was a spear that went into the chest. In the Journal of American Medical Association, in the Journal of the American Medical Association, just about 15 years ago, we were told that Jesus' death came from a fixation. The researchers said, including a pathologist from the Mayo Clinic, they said that the spear entered his heart and the water came running out. How do you know, Reverend? Well, I'm reading and telling you what they said, and I believe it happened that way. The water came from the sac surrounding the heart called the pericardium. So Jesus was dead, but if he wasn't, the death blow would have done it in. Well, he was flogged, my sisters and brothers. Flogging in that day, flogging was a legal preliminary to every Roman execution. In other words, if you were going to be put on the cross, you had to get a flogging before you went there. And mind me now, only women and Roman senators or soldiers, except in cases of desertion, were exempt from execution. Well, the usual instrument was a short whip with several single or braided leather thongs of variable length in which small iron balls or sharp pieces of sheep bone were tied in intervals. Well, occasionally, staves also were used tied in intervals. But mind me now, occasionally, it was used for scourging. For scourging, the man was stripped of his clothes. He was stripped of his clothes. And in other words, his back, his buttocks, and his legs were exposed to the soldier or the listener.
Yes, sir.
Who was the one that whipped him, or by one who alternated position. In other words, that was at most times that would be two or three.
Yeah.
Because when one get tired, the other would begin. And then they would alternate back and forth until they had whipped him down. Well, my sisters and brothers, the severity of the scourging depended on the disposition of the listener, and was intended to weaken the victim so to shorten his death link on the cross. After the scourging, the soldiers often taunted thou victim. The medical aspect of scourging is this: as the Roman soldiers repeatedly struck the victim's back with full force, the iron balls would cause deep contusion, and the leather thongs and sheep bone would cut into the skin and subcutaneous tissue. Then, as the flogging continued, the lacerations would tear in the underlying skeletal muscles and produce quivering in the body. Plain pain and blood loss generally set the stage for circulatory shock. The extent of blood loss was may well have determined how long the victim survived on the cross. Well, let's look at the scourging of Jesus, our Savior. At the Praetorium, Jesus was severely beaten. Although the severity of the scourging is not discussed in the four gospel accounts, it is simply implied in one of the epistles, in the epistle of Peter, around 1 Peter 2:24. A detailed work study of the ancient Greek text for this verse indicates, my sisters and brothers, that the scourging of Jesus was particularly harsh.
Yeah.
It is not known whether the number of lashes was limited to 39, as normally would be the Jewish law. The Roman soldiers, amused that this weakened man had claimed to be a king, they began mocking him by placing a robe on his shoulder, a crown of thorns on his head, and a wooden staff in his hand as a scepter. Well, next they spat on Jesus and struck him on the head with the wooden staff. Moreover, when the soldiers tore the robe from Jesus' back, they probably reopened the scourging wound. Well, the severe scourging, with its intense pain and appreciable blood loss, most probably left Jesus in pre-shock condition. Moreover, my sisters and brothers, I want you to know it was mental abuse as well, meted out by the Jews and the Romans, as well as the lack of food and water, as well as sleep that contributed to the general weakened state of Jesus. Well, therefore, even before the actual crucifixion, Jesus' physical condition was at least serious and possibly critical. Jesus of Nazareth underwent Jewish and Roman trials, was flogged and sentenced to death by crucifixion. The scourging produced deep stripes like laceration and appreciable blood loss, and it is probably set the stage for the hypervolemic shock, as evidenced by the fact that Jesus was too weakened to carry the cross up to Calvary. At the sight of the crucifixion, his nailed wrists were nailed to the patibulum, which was called the cross bar. And after the patibulum was lifted up and an uprun to an upright post, called the stipe. His feet were nailed to the stipe. Well, Ray Stedman asked an indicting question in our day, and Ray Stedman is also a white minister, but he asked an indicting question in our day. And the question is it not strange that we who call ourselves Christian seek to live as kings, but he who was the king of kings lived like a pauper? Well, how much does it cost, my sisters and brothers, to give? Well, I want to tell you something. It cost Jesus everything. He suffered it all for you and me. He suffered it all for you. Lord have mercy. If you are not a believer in the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, along with Gavin Newsom, if you have not opened your eyes to the depth of his love that God showed for you, if you do not understand the sacrifice he made on your behalf, if you are physically here but are yet spiritually holding God at arm's length, while if you are alienated from God, or if you have never surrendered yourself to God, well, have you longed for sweet peace and for faith to increase? Well, have you earnestly and fervently prayed, but you cannot find rest nor be perfectly blessed until all on the altar is laid? Well, can I tell somebody this morning, you can only be blessed and have peace and sweet rest as you yield him your body and soul. Well, if it's been a long time since you, Lord have mercy, and God were on good terms, this movie left a hole in my heart for the rest of my life and time here in earth. He gave me a new and profound meaning of the word suffering. Nothing I will ever suffer for him can compare to what he's already suffered for me. Why don't you say he's already suffered? Well, my sisters and brothers, my suffering in this life, in this body, don't compare to the suffering of Jesus Christ. Can I truly just say the depth of his suffering are indescribable? Well, I remember the words of the songwriter as he said, I won't complain. Well, when they enter my mind, I want to talk to you just a moment and tell you, somebody who's thinking about missing worship service because your head is hurting, my word to you is don't complain. The next time you have to leave your house on Wednesday night to go to midweek service, don't complain. When Sunday morning arrives and Sunday school summons you, get up from the bed and don't complain. Well, Jesus did not suffer so that you could stay home on Sunday morning. He didn't die to allow you to skip Sunday school and Bible study. You ought to be convicted now, but I was fully awakened to the excruciating pain and agony. He was unjustly dead. Every blow was like a knife twisting in my heart as I heard the sour notes of skin setting sail from skin. And the instrument of inhumane torture kissing bone with vehemently velocity of force. I now know how his pain escalated with each passing moment. I now know more. His heart felt like someone was sticking darts into it. His face had been carved into an ugly mask. He suffered it all for you and me. Tell your neighbor he cares about you. For Peter said, cast all your cares upon him, for he cared for you. Well, he gave up his life and everything he had just for me and just for you. He laid everything aside for me. Well, my sisters and brothers, ambition was laid aside. Bragging rights were laid aside. His own agenda was laid aside. When he was rich in love and had all the angels of heaven adoring him, he continually bowing down as Isaiah tells us, crying out, holy, holy, holy is the Lord of hosts. But I come by to tell you, he laid it aside. Yes, I know he became poor and he came to be one of whom I heard the prophet Isaiah write and say, he was despised and rejected of men. We esteemed him not. He was stricken, smitten by God, and afflicted. He laid it all aside. I know he was rich in resources when everything was his because of him and through him and to him all things. The Apostle Paul writes, but I'm glad he came so that he could say of himself, the Son of Man had not place to lay his head. He laid his all aside for you and me. He had no home to call his own. Look at your neighbor's and neighbor. He suffered for me. They had to borrow a manger in which to he could be born. Look at your neighbor's there, and he suffered this for me. Well, I know he had to borrow a penny to pay his taxes when he wanted to perform a miracle, and he suffered this for you and me. I know that when he died, they had to borrow a grave in which to lay his body. He had no place, nothing of his own, and he suffered this for me. Well, John put it in one pregnant phrase and said, having loved his own, he loved him unto the end. Well, he went the entire limit and he suffered it all for you and me. Well, I'm glad he was obedient unto death, even the death of the cross, and he suffered for me. Well, that's why the songwriter declared, you can't be God-giving no matter how you try. Lord have mercy, Jesus had no reservation and he suffered it for me and for you. There were no conditions on his sacrifice and he suffered this for me. Well, no holding back. No holding back. He suffered for me. He gave everything he had for a little country boy like me. Caiaphas judged him, but he failed. Well, Judas betrayed him, he failed. Simon of Cyrene mocked and he failed. Mark ran away and he failed. Pilate equivocates and he fails. The crowd mocked Jesus. I want to tell you, they also fail. The soldiers laughed at him. They also fail. The centurion carried out his order, but he failed. Lord have mercy. And Jesus, them all, with a glance, they still turned turned away. Jesus' friend, they all failed him. Well, everybody and everything failed, but Jesus Christ. Look at your neighbor and say, neighbor, he never failed. God never failed. Heaven to shed a single mighty tear as blood and water spilled out his side. The complacency of all creation is ever shattered. I'm getting ready to close here. I don't know about you, but when I look at what he done for me, it makes me want to shout hallelujah, glory, hallelujah. Well, I'm going to close here this morning when I tell you a few more things. The Bible said Satan left him until a more opportune time. And when the devil had ended all the temptation, the Bible said he departed Jesus for a season. I can imagine Satan never quit attempting Jesus. But this film captured beyond words the most inopportune time. What do you mean, Reverend? Well, on his way to Calvary was an inopportune time, but Satan tempted him. Yes, Lord, on the cross was an inopportune time when they put the crown of thorns on his head. It was an inopportune time when they pierced him in the side. It was an inopportune time. And at every step of the way, Satan is there at Jesus' side trying to tempt him. Lord, have mercy. Look at your neighbor and say, neighbor. Satan didn't leave Jesus alone, but tell him Satan was there. Yes, Lord, his disciples weren't there. His inner circle was not there. The angels were not there. All the people whose burdens he had lifted were not there. All the terminal ill men, women, boys, and girls that he healed in the earth, they were not there. All of them who had been beneficiaries of his mighty miracles were not there. On the cross, the multitude he fed with 2 fish and 2 barley loaves, they were not there. James and John, who wanted to sit on his right and his left hand in his kingdom, they were not there. Peter, his 8-spoon coon, was not there. Yes, Lord, but Satan was right there imploring Jesus, you need to quit, you need to give up, because ain't none of them here with you. Yes, Lord, he was there reasoning with Jesus, saying, give it up. He was there seducing Jesus, saying, you need to surrender. Can I tell you this morning, now I understand the devil that was there. I understand the evil that was at his very elbow. He should have quit, but he didn't. He could have quit. Anybody else would have quit. I have to be honest, I would have quit. Yes, Lord, he should have opened his mouth. But the Bible said he opened not his mouth. He should have called 10,000 angels. He should have come
Satan tried to get him to quit, but he suffered from me. I came to tell the world there is a fountain filled with blood drawn from Emmanuel's brain, and sinners plunged beneath that flood called Jesus' blood. Wait a minute, Reverend, but I got another to add to it. I got one more thing to tell you on it. I'm getting happy all by myself. They say you lose all that guilt and shame. Can I get a witness here? At the cross, where I first saw the light and the burden of my heart was rolled away. I wish I had five people. I'll be number six up in here. I just wish I had some friends in this house. It was there by faith I received my sight, and now I'm happy all the day. Is anybody happy up in here? Anybody happy? He was wounded for my transgression. Anybody happy that he was bruised for my iniquity? Anybody happy that the chastisement of our peace was upon him? Somebody say, my peace. My peace was upon him, and with his stripes I'm healed. I don't know about you this morning, but I'm healed by his wounded side. Yes, Lord, if you don't ever see me anymore, just remember what happened on Good Friday. He died. Satan was there. You were not there. I was not there. But Satan was there. And he told him, no, I got to die for a little boy in Columbia, Mississippi, by the name of Calvin Newsom. He suffered for me. He suffered. He cried. But Sunday morning, when Satan thought he had him in the pits of hell, that was a rumbling. They tried to hold him, but he walked right out, and he stood there and declared, all power in heaven and earth is in my hand. If you don't know the Lord, you ought to know him now. He died, but he rose again.
Glory to your name.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
The Spirit is in the house. I'm sorry if you didn't feel it. But it's here. Thank you, Lord. Thank you. What a word. What a word.
Thank you, Lord.
He suffered it all. It's personal. Just for me. Hey! Thank you. Did not our hearts burn? Oh,
yeah.
Pastor stood here and painted the picture. I don't know about you, but I found myself standing at the cross. I found myself seeing the torture, seeing the anguish, seeing the pain. And our Lord stood, this took everything. The passion of Christ. His suffering. What he done for you and me. Not what they did to Jesus, but what Jesus did for you and me. The scripture says he didn't say a mumbling word. He didn't open his mouth. Just took it all in stride because he knew one day. A little boy by the name of Steve Aiden gonna need a savior. And I thank him. Let's give the Lord a hand out of praise. As the musician plays, choir singing, congregation standing throughout the building, it's time for you to surrender all to Jesus.
Yes, Lord.
If you want that peace and that sweet rest, you got to lay it all. Oh, no. The songwriter said, must Jesus bear that cross alone and all the world go free.
Mama.
You know, my suffering, and matter of fact, our suffering that we go through down here, we should not complain.
Yeah.
In comparison to what Jesus done. See, a little amount of setbacks, a little amount of aches, there's nothing compared to what he went through. Yes, it was at the cross. At the cross. Hallelujah. He suffered it all. Obedient. Even unto death. He knew his mission. Yes, he could have spoken. And legions of angels would have came. But he said not a word. For such a worm, just as you and me. If you're here and you're not saved, you need to come. You need to come and receive just what he done just for you. The suffering, the pain. It's time. It's what a burden of our heart. He was committed to you and me. Like Pastor said, I believe I would have had to give up, Pastor. Too much pain, too much suffering. But thank God he didn't give up. He didn't give up on you, and he's still not giving up on us now. No matter what state we in right now, he's still not going to give up on us. We still have an opportunity. Amen. Amen. We're going to ask our officers if they would to come at this time.